Few seconds.
Oh, no, not anymore.
Okay, so welcome to MIE 100. Thank you for coming. This is one of the better lecture halls we can get, but that's MedSci for you. Just a couple things before I start. I do try and give you my lecture notes, so I'm writing them in OneNote. I will be providing a version of them probably on a chapter basis or a concept basis. It depends on how many lectures at a time. So the first set of notes that I'll give you from this set will be the first 8 lectures. I may give it to you after 6 because of the quiz. So today, what I'm trying to do is cover really what the goals of the course are, introduce myself. I'm Professor Sullivan. I'm in the upper left there. Lecture room here is going to be this room Monday and Thursday, and Bayan 1190 on Wednesday. And it's all at the same time, 2 to 3 p.m. Each of the other lecturers are pictured here. Professor Sinclair, for example, already started his lectures. The goal here today is really to start defining that, but also start talking a little bit about position, velocity, and acceleration for particles. Those of you who've looked at Quercus, and I know quite a few have already done so, know that there are available to you a number of concept videos and notes. So I do have an older set of notes that I developed in 2022 that look like that one right there. They are largely based on the notes I'm giving you now, so if you want a copy of everything that I'm going to talk about, basically, you can get it today. It's either a 2 or 3. It's Quercus. The concept videos are a little bit different. They follow along with the lecture, so each week you're getting a small list of videos, and it links to a YouTube channel. I used to use MyMedia and Stream. Turned out to be kind of a pain in the neck for me, so I only do these on YouTube right now. It's a lot easier for me to upload and do things with that. So if you want to take a look at them, they're all there. And what they are is they take each of the ideas from the lectures. So for example, you'll see a list like this, where you will have the chapter, for example. It used to be that we did Merriam and Craig and another book called Hibbler. Both books are great. I don't know if anyone's still using the Hibbler text, but if you are, that's super. But you won't have the homework. So make sure you have a copy of Wiley Plus. Wiley Plus, if you buy it through the bookstore, you get a discounted cost of, I forget how much, $65. And that includes a textbook for one term. So one term or 1 year, I don't know. So what I try to do is release a list. It gives you the chapter. It tells you what lecture this is basically from, what the title of the video is, particle velocity and acceleration, for example, and something about what we're talking about in there. So different, define what we mean by particles, rigid bodies, vector kinematics. So just a starting point for all of the course. We cover a lot of material in this course. We cover a great deal of material, and frankly, we cover a lot in the first 8 lectures. Chapter 2 is the most packed in terms of new ideas and follow on to ideas that you've used in the past. We omit certain sections, so for example, 2.2.2.7, but for example, I'll cover parts of 2.2 and talk about graphical methods because I think it's helpful to develop an intuition of what you're dealing with here. Chapters 3 and 4, 5, 6, and 8, we don't cover 7. We cover basically two main concepts in the course, motion of particles and the forces driving them, and motion and forces of acting on rigid bodies. So roughly around reading week, we sort of change gear a lot. There you go, same textbook. If you want a copy, it's great. It's a super textbook, really useful to have. You can also certainly buy them online and just buy a Biley Plus. They're a lot cheaper if you buy a used copy. One thing for Wiley Plus, and this was something that drove me crazy when trying to solve problems, if you do not use 9.81 meters per second squared, you will get a wrong answer. And so it ends up that a couple problems that we have done in the past are very sensitive to that sort of precision. So just to be aware of that as you're solving these problems. Homework is on Wiley Plus, and we've already created an account, and you should have access. I do know quite a few people have already signed up for Wiley Plus. Please do not try and figure out Wiley Plus the day before the homework is due. The homework is not meant to be overly burdensome, but learning Wiley Plus at the same time may be a bit too much. And you should receive it around December 20th already, and there was a second one, I think last week, sent to you with login information. Tutorials start on Friday. So if you have a tutorial scheduled in the next few days, you don't have it until Friday. I don't put the room numbers here. I think the room numbers are on the syllabus. I can check later. But the time should be right. Please, if you can, check your ACORN schedule just in case at the last moment the faculty does decide to change a room. We're also going to use Piazza. I know, again, you're doing five courses. You've got a lot on your plate, and it's hard to come in for office hours. We do have office hours, by the way. It's good to see people when you come by. But Piazza is also available for this kind of purpose, talking about homework, talking about administrative issues. So people have already contacted me on Piazza, and you'll see a few responses on that. And it should be active on your Quercus. The final exam is Type D, which is a 8-sheet. I have put on Piazza what it is, but it's an 8.5-inch sheet of paper, both sides printed, handwritten. You know, whatever you want to do to that piece of paper, it's yours. However, you will find in one of the modules a crib sheet, cheat sheet, I forget what we call, or I called it, but there you go, with some examples. There's one from our, which we had created, one which was created by school. The school one I have corrected because there were a couple small errors in it. So make sure that if you use whichever one, that everything is correct. Now, one of the things is also over time, formulas change because we use different notation for unit vectors and things like that. I do try to keep up with them, but maybe it won't be there. First quiz is on January 30th. The midterm is on March 7th. And we have online assignments, which are 10% of the course. That's the online is Wiley Plus. Okay. Any questions on that?
How long are the
quiz is 75 minutes, midterm is 90 minutes.
Oh, no.
Okay. There's one quiz. Basically, there's two midterms in the course. One which is on January 30th, one which is on March 7th. That's the only exam other than, of course, the final. Okay. Any other questions on that?
What do we
That's it. This one. The whole course is an attempt to teach you sum of forces equals mass times acceleration. And acceleration is the first real part of the course. So when we talk about kinematics, we're going to be talking about that. The difference with SIG 100 is that sum of forces is equal to zero. For us, sum of forces equals mass times acceleration. So that becomes a lot more complex because we look at very more complex situations. We break that up into two parts. Kinematics, which is the geometric aspects of the motion. What kind of motion is occurring? Projectile moving, plate being spun, that sort of thing. That is chapter 2 and 5. Chapters 3 and 4 are about the same. They still talk about particles. Sorry, I should say 2 is particles, 5 is rigid bodies. 3 and 4 are particles. 6 is rigid bodies. And 8 is going to be vibrations. And vibrations will look at both particle motion and rigid bodies. What you'll notice here, and we'll talk about in a lot more detail, is that these three equations are the same. So acceleration is equal to very simply this. And we'll talk about when to use each of those equations for those particular cases. So to start with, we're going to look at one-dimensional kind of motion. Left, right, up, down, but nothing more exciting than that. And so I have a particle, and I can define its position as being either r vector, which gives me magnitude and direction, or s, which is a scalar. So vector, position and direction with respect to the origin, scalar, is just magnitude with respect to origin. So in this particular case, say that it displaced by 1 meter. For r, I would use eventually 1 meter. But for s, I would just say 1 meter. So I'm just giving magnitudes for s, magnitude and direction, I being a vector in the x direction. If the particle displaces over here, I can refer to that as either S prime or R prime. That's a new position. And if I do that, I can refer to it either as delta r or delta s. So change in position, say displaced by a tenth of a meter, then delta r is 0.1 I, delta s is 0.1 meters. Both, and in all your calculations, one of the most important things you can do, and I kind of spent more time on this on the video, and I probably should just mention this. I do kind of encourage you to try out MathCAD Prime, SMath Desktop, anything that forces you to write out your solutions with units, so that as you get used to the idea, you know that your answers are correct or in the right form. It sort of reinforces that. So the displacement is just going to be delta S equals S prime minus S, or delta R equals R prime minus R. And again, I will make mistakes with this, but it's really important that you keep the vector hat on there to make sure that you highlight that you're dealing with vectors or not. So if that displacement occurs over some time, so I've displaced over a meter, over a second, I can find a velocity for that.
Oh, wait a minute.
One other thing I should mention, and since I've seen meters or feet. We don't do any problems on an exam, and I'll still be asked this. We will never do an English units problem on an exam. We may give you, and I think we do give you, homework problems with those. And the homework problems inevitably run into a problem because people will write G equals 9.81, not put the units in, and not realize where the error occurs. So as you're doing your homework, as you're doing things that involve English units, make sure you know it's 32.1 feet per second squared. Okay. So if we have something that's traveling, some sort of displacement that occurs over some time, I can define the velocity. And the velocity is just going to be delta R over delta T. It will have units of meters per second or feet per second. Length over time.
There are a lot of unit systems out there, and you can do all sorts of things with them, but the main thing is that length over time is what you need.
So this, for example, has displaced either delta RT, or delta R vector, or S sub T, that's the displacement over time, and V average is equal to sort of S sub T over delta T. So if we have this vector quantity, we can take it to the limit of delta t approaching 0. If delta t approaches 0, delta r over delta t then becomes delta dr over dt. And that becomes, again, a fundamental definition that we use in terms of The magnitude of that velocity is the speed. And so it's not, again, it only depends on magnitude, not direction. These terms right here, this one and this one, depend on direction. So they have magnitude and direction. We'll do some examples later on that. So if I have now two particles, and I should do that. If I have two particles that are traveling along, at time one, it has a velocity v. At time two, it has a velocity v prime. T1, T2. It will have units of meters per second squared, feet per second squared, or length over time squared. And I can write that as an average acceleration. Average acceleration is delta v over delta t. And then acceleration in the limit as delta t approaches zero of delta v over delta t is dv dt. Okay. So I have acceleration now in that form. So A equals dv dt. A is also equal to d dt of dr. Which is just the second derivative of position dt. And a useful sort of thing to remember is that with dv dt, I can write that as over ds over v, which is equal to v dv ds. And there, all I've done is substitute in that relationship. This is not a very good v. Just substitute the relationship where I know that dt, or ds, is equal to dv dt. Our v is equal to ds dt. All right. So main definitions, and the main thing is we have this relationship, we have that relationship, and we have the other one in the green, big green box. So we can look at velocity and state. Go back to these.
recognize that A sub C is a constant acceleration, like you'll see with gravity, which is 9.81 meters per second squared. Substitute it in. Integrate. And you have one relationship that we'll use a lot. Velocity final is equal to velocity initial plus the acceleration constant times time. And all you've done is split this integral up, bring dt onto that side, dv integrated from v naught to vf, 0 to t, ac dt. So we tend to do things that mathematicians don't really enjoy. If you have position as a function of time, then you can rewrite this expression the same way. You can say V is equal to ds dt. Do the same split. And you end up with an equation that, again, you may already recognize. For position as a function of time. Is equal to this relationship, which we already have up there, V naught, which is constant, AC, which is constant, T, which is the variable of interest, from 0 to final time, dt, and you end up with final position equals initial position plus initial velocity times time, and there was a little dot there. Plus 1/2 ACT squared. You already probably recognize this as a projectile equation, and you've used forms of this in already. Now we derived a relationship just a few moments ago looking at velocity as a function of position. So velocity is a function of S. And that's the final relationship we have. Now, the only problem with this is both the top equation for velocity and the bottom equation for velocity are not independent. So, not independent. So, chapter, go into coordinates.
Yeah, pretty much everything on the first part of chapter 2. Any questions on this one?
All right, so these are kind of, again, fundamental definitions that we're going to work with.
And let's start with an example.
Over 30 meters. Displacement is in the x direction as shown. V naught, brakes are applied at a rate of 3 meters per second squared. Car comes to rest in 30 meters. How fast was the car going just after the brakes were applied? Time required for the car to stop.
So, the first thing I have to recognize is that the acceleration of the car is constant. And it's decelerating at a rate of 3 meters per second squared.
So in order to indicate that, I'm going to put a negative sign. It starts out with a V naught, it ends up with a V final. V naught is unknown, V final is zero. Constant acceleration, minus 3 meters per second squared.
And I have constant acceleration. So I can use these relationships.
So V, 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 X, I'm going to use X as my coordinate system, and I will probably sort of default to that because S gets confusing.
So V, 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 X is equal to minus 3 meters per second squared. I have V naught, zero as the final velocity. V, V, V is equal to zero to the x final, which is going to be ac dx. So I'm just putting in terms.
V is my unknown. I don't know what the initial velocity is. I know what the final velocity is. I know what the distance is because I'm given that in the problem. It's 30 meters. So comes to rest, ac dx.
And as it comes to rest, I can rewrite this expression as v naught, 0, v, 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 even in variable form, 0, x sub f, minus 3 meters per second squared, dx.
Again, the minus is very important because otherwise I have an increase in velocity.
All right, so what I have here,
and what I should be doing, again, good practice, is writing out all the units that I have. So I have right now, and I've kind of separated the parts of, you know, the calculation of the units into this part. So I've got 3 meters, minus 3 meters per second squared, and x sub s, which
is 30 meters. So minus v naught squared divided by 2 is minus 3 meters per second squared times 30 meters. And it's positive because it's moving to the right.
So minus 3 meters per second squared, 30 meters. Minus V naught squared, put all the terms together, get everything there.
I get V naught squared
equals 180 meters per second squared. Good news is everything makes sense and the units work. And if I take the square root, I get 13.4 meters per second.
So by including those units,
I also have a little bit of confidence that the numbers that I'm coming up with make sense. So 13.4 meters per second.
And the only thing I did wrong there was that.
So when I take the square root of my unit, it has to end up being meters per second. The square root of magnitude is a separate part of this.
Now, for the second part, I'm going to sort of say, hey, I'm not really solving for anything or solving for velocity again. I'm just solving for the time. The time has to be obtainable from my equations. If it is true,
I can rewrite this expression as V naught 0 dv equals a dt. Still a constant. And 0 to time final.
So I've got time final, I've got all the terms there. I already know what V is, of V naught, excuse me, that's V naught.
And I can substitute in the terms, 0 minus V sub naught equals 2 minus 3 T sub F. And now it's going to be meters per second squared times seconds. So checking my units,
I will get the right units in this case,
meters per second.
So I got all the terms. The only thing that I don't know is T sub F.
And so the total time is basically 4.5 seconds.
Again, these are fundamental definitions that depend on one thing in these two, or this example here. That is that the acceleration is constant. So a sub c isn't varying with time. I have a different problem if I do have to deal with that. We'll talk about those cases.
Any questions on this one? Okay.
I have ship B, which is monitoring ship A from a drone that's flying over the water. P's motion is given by this function R sub T.
Maybe I shouldn't do this one. Maybe I shouldn't do this. I should at least talk a little bit about coordinate systems before I start doing that.
Simple one, or more relevant one. I have a ball I'm tossing from a corner. I know that its acceleration
is going to be gravitational acceleration, so negative 9.81 meters per second squared. It's given an initial velocity vertically of 10 meters per second. And it's sort of thrown up in the air, and it's going to come back down. Now this is a one-dimensional problem because it just goes vertical, left or up, down. And you're asked to find velocity and elevation above ground at time t, the highest elevation reached by the ball in the corresponding time, and time when the ball will hit the ground and the corresponding velocity. So,
just see if I can make that a little bit easier to read.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to integrate twice. I'm not going to use s, I'm going to use y as my coordinate system, and y is going to be defined from the ground. And it's important, when you solve these problems, write your unit, write your origin. Once you write your origin, you can always draw a picture and see where you are. Don't try to imagine where you are. Integrate twice, and find b sub t, or once for b sub t, y sub t. Solve for t at which the velocity equals 0, which is the maximum maximum elevation, and evaluate the corresponding altitude. Solve for time which altitude equals 0, time for its ground impact, and find the corresponding ground velocity just before the impact. And you'll have a lot of problems like this where you have an object that's approaching the ground and you're asked to find the velocity just before impact. So the right answer is not 0.
Oops.
So we can do something
which we kind of skip in the course, but I think is useful to sort of look at, is look at what the plot looks like. So the velocity time curve is going to decrease as soon as you release the ball. As soon as you throw the ball up in the air, it will start to decelerate because it wants to go back down to the ground. So it will eventually reach a point where the velocity is 0. And then it will continue falling until it reaches y equals 0.
So
second squared.
I'm going to do the same thing, v naught to vt of dv equals to minus the integral from 0 to t of 9.81 meters per second squared vt. Whoop. So v sub t minus v sub naught equals minus 9.81 t. V is a function of time, is equal to 10 meters per second minus 9.81 meters per second squared times time.
So all my units match. Side. That's in meters per second. This is meters per second squared times seconds, and I get meters per second.
So if I integrate this again, dy dt is equal to v, which equals 210 minus 9.81t, and integrate y naught to y is a function of time, y dy is equal to the integral 0 to t of 10 minus 9.81t dt. So that mess ends up being y of t is equal to 20 meters,
which is my y naught.
That's where it started.
Plus
10 meters per second, because that's a positive value times time, minus 4.905 meters per second squared, t squared.
So now I have two expressions for velocity as a function of time. I have position as a function of time. And over here, I can see that y is increasing and decreasing. Now it's parabolic, but it's actually a linear motion. So y is increasing slowly and then decreasing much more quickly. And it will reach zero at 3.8 seconds.
So if we go back to this, velocity as a function of time is equal to 10 meters per second minus 9.81 meters per second squared times time. I get a time of 1.019 seconds for this t equals 0. So the peak of this is there at that.
So that's the maximum. Or sorry, that's the zero velocity. It is the maximum height.
I'm not going to put units here. You'll have to. Oops. I'm just using this relationship over there. Substitute in those terms, t is equal to 1.019 seconds, and I get y at the maximum height of 25.1 meters. If I solve for y of t equal to 0, that will occur at 3.28 seconds. And the velocity at that time, I know that I'm running right to the end here, is equal to minus 22.2 meters per second before it reaches the ground. And all I'm doing is saying, okay, y is equal to 0. How long does it take? Well, it takes 3.28 seconds. That's in that graph. And the corresponding velocity is going to be 22.2 meters per second. And I can plot it out.
People don't do it as much, or I can calculate it. I will see you on Wednesday.